Isang magandang umaga po sa lahat. Aking po part ngayon ay ating pong i-introduce at ipanalangin po yung ating pong magbibigay ng devotional this morning. Siya po ay si Pastor Ryan Tolentino. Siya po ay nag-work as a district pastor from Central Luzon Conference, and he is now serving the LNG White States of Ayas. So ngayon, kung mga bagay na tungkol kay pastor, siguro like the other pastors, they are also gifted in the ministry. And particularly the ministry of pastor na nagbigay sa akin ng naging recipient ng blessing para sa akin is the discipleship, leadership, and especially the devotional. So ganyan guys, ay mamumula siya sa atin para sa ating devotional. Ang ganyan topic is about the grace of God, no? By the grace of God, we are praying na nawa ay gamitin rin siya ngayon upang magkaroon tayo ng isang magandang isang devotional life na magkakaroon ng transformation of with our character. So I'm with pastor, like for example, yung amin pong survival camp. He's using the pastor guide to ministry to disciple people. He's using the canvassing work and anything para magkaroon ng discipleship. And I hope we will be discipled by the grace of God also. This kind of program, the PYC. So I invite everyone to please kneel with me as we pray. Let's pray. Dakilang naming Diyos, kami po ay nagpupuri. Nagpapasalamat sa iyong banal na kabutihan, kalooban, at sa iyong patuloy na biyaya na siyang nananahan sa bawat isa, na siya na rin nagdala sa amin, Panginoon, sa lugar na ito upang kami po ay makinig, mag-aral, at makaranas ng iyong banal na salita. Ngayon, Panginoon, ay magkakaroon kami ng devotional. Tanging hiling po namin, Panginoon, na sa pamamagitan ng taong iyong gagamitin ngayon sa umaga ito, kayo po nawa ang bahayag. At nubahin niya po si pastor sa kanyang pong pagsasalita sa kabila rin ng kanyang kahinaan man o pagiging tao ay kayo po, Panginoon, ang divine nature niyo po nawa, Panginoon, ang siyang gumawa upang kami po ay makareceive ng mensahe na nais niyo po iparating sa amin. Hiniling amin din po itinatalaga, Panginoon, ang topic na bubuksan ngayon sa aklat ng Lucas about sa prodigal son na magpapakita ng iyong grasya. Ay mapasa amin dinawa ang grasya nito upang ang aming buhay ay magkaroon ng transformation na matapos sa devotional na ito na mayroong pagbabago sa aming buhay na kami po ay makakaramdam na kami tinawagan po ninyo upang kami ay magkaroon ng pagsisisi sa aming mga kasalanan at magkakaroon ng pag-iunlad at pag-cross namin kay Kristo. Salamat, Panginoon. Patawarin mo kami kung saan kami nagkulang at nagkasala. At hinihiling namin na ang banal na Espiritu Santo ang siyang mangunanawa sa amin. Alang-alang ang lahat sa pangalan ni Jesus. Amen.
Good morning, PYC.
Good morning.
Good morning, PYC. Biko. I remember the time when I was here in Bicol, especially in Naga, where I met my wife, Naling. It was during the time when I was having field school. In evangelism, I met my wife. Amen? Saan niyo gusto ma-meet ang inyong mapapakasawa? It should be the work of God. Amen? And I remember last year when we had a PYC in IIRR in Silao. And we organized coordinators from every missions and conference. And you know what? Surprisingly, there was only one mission that was not represented all throughout the Philippines. It was Southern Luzon Mission. And Brother Eldrin Umatto was there. And he was speaking with me. He said, "Sayang, Pastor, wala man lang kahit isa na galing sa Bicol." And then we pray. "Pastor, sana magkaroon na. Ma'am, sana mayroon makarating dito. Sana madalay ko sa Bicol." And that prayer was very sincere. And now, Brother Umatto is already in light, in Wildwood. And he's still praying. And I told him that this is now the time for you to remember your own prayer. Hindi, ito na po, from PYC, this is the first time na magkakaroon ng PYC outside of PYC itself. This is PYC Bicol. And this is a triumph for the Lord. Amen? Amen? And please pray. Please pray for yourselves as I speak. And please pray for my speaking. Pray for my heart. Pray for the message as well. Let us now meditate upon the Word of God, and let me kneel as I pray again that we may open our hearts. Okay? Bow down your heads. Gracious God, I represent the Word of God now. And Father, I pray that the precious Holy Spirit would have the key to open our hearts today as I speak. And I pray, Heavenly Father, that the sweet power of the Holy Spirit will consume our sins and will open our minds and hearts for the reception of the power of the Holy Spirit. I pray that every word that would come out from the Scripture and from your mouth would be a powerful guide in our lives, a changing, life-changing, life-transforming word. In Christ's worthy name we pray. Amen. The title of the message today is found in Luke, is the grace of God. It's found in Luke chapter 15, verse 11 to 31. So open your Bible in Luke chapter 15, verse 11 to 31. Actually, we're going to begin with verse 1. It says, "Then all the tax collectors and the sinners drew near to him and to hear him. And the Pharisees and scribes complained, saying, 'This man receives sinners and eats with them.'" So the message that we are about to listen has the context that Jesus Christ was eating with the sinners, and that the scribes and Pharisees were jealous that Jesus Christ was eating with and receiving sinners and eats with them. So he started the parable. And it was the parable of the lost sheep. And you know the parable of the lost sheep. There were about 100 sheep that was being flocked by Jesus, by the shepherd. And so the time came when he was counting the sheep, and it was lacking how many? One. One out of 100 is how many percent? How many percent? 1%. And you see, one of the characteristics of a sheep is when he is lost, he does not know how to go back. He knew that he is lost, but he does not know how to go back. You know, many times we knew that we are lost, but we don't know how to go back. But this is just one of the problem. During the Hebrew time, to have a possession that is incomplete is shameful. Halimbawa, may 100 ka, tapos nawawala yung isa. This is shameful. This is negligence. And sometimes you think that you are irresponsible, and you don't want everybody to know that you lost something. So this is a little bit of shame when you are losing one because it's incomplete. Whatever is complete is honorable, and whatever is incomplete is not honorable. It is shame. But let's go to the second parable of the Lord Jesus Christ. And he's talking about parables. He was talking about 10 silver coins. And how many was lost? One. So what did the owner do? He tried to light a lamp, tried to clean the whole house, and when he found the one, he was very happy, or she was very happy, and invited the whole neighborhood, just the same with the first, with the shepherd. He invited the whole neighborhood and rejoiced over one, over one coin or over one sheep. See, let's reflect a little bit before we go to the next. How many percent is one coin out of 10? How many percent? If you lose one out of 100, this is already shameful because it's incomplete. What if you lose one out of 10? And mind you, these are silver. Silver can buy lots of things. And you're losing a lot. So he was losing a lot, and he was losing. And what is amazing is losing something inside his house. Marami sa mga dumadalo sa church, hindi nila alam. Nasa loob lang sila ng church, pero sila iligaw. And so what is very amazing is, hindi alam ng coin na siya naliligaw. And most probably, hindi rin niya alam kung paano babalik. Marami sa mga precious silver within the church are lost. They don't know that they are lost, and they don't know how to go back. That's the real problem. So you can't boast, hindi ka pwede magmayabang na, actually, nagsisimba naman, nag-iika po ako, kumagawa ko nito. But if you are not converted, you are a silver that is lost. And yet the father or the owner would do his best to what? To find you a light, a lamp, and clean the whole house. And when he finds you, he will rejoice with you. And yet these are only preambles of what he's about to say. The next parable is the most important parable. The first two parables were just what? Prelude. Were just introduction. Were just foundations of what he's about to say. And let me tell you about the third parable. The third parable is a parable of the lost son. How many sons were there in the parable? Two. How many was lost? One. And what do you think is the percentage between one out of two? And what percentages of shame there is if you lose one out of two? Greater shame. Not only 1%, not only 10%, but you're losing half of what you got. Now if I tell you that he's losing all that he got, would you tell me that it's more shameful or most shameful? Now I'm not going to tell you now what has happened, but let me tell you little by little what happened. As soon as he lost his son, you know, in Adam's time, when Adam fell, God, I'm sorry, so you don't want to project. It was the lost sheep, the lost silver, and the lost son. Every time God loses a son, he would always ask the question, where art thou? And even in the times of Adam, the first thing God do is what? To find his son. And he would always look for his son and do his best to recover the son. And how did he recover his own son? Adam? By killing a lamb, providing a sacrifice for him in order for him to be redeemed. And you know, in Christ's Object Lesson, page 202, what made the son go back to his father? What made the son go back to his father? What was the motivating factor? The Spirit promises it was the father's love that convinced the son to come. What if you have a father who is so cruel and every day would tell you to go out of the house and would not dare to forgive you and tells you that this is the end of it, you can never anymore hope for any forgiveness. Would you go back to your house? Is there any hope of going back to the house? See, because the character of the father draws the son goes back, going back to the house, that makes it possible for the son who was lost to go back. Now let us see a little bit of what happened. In a very obscure land, when farming was the best way of, you know, living, there was a son, there were two sons who lived with a father, and the father had a good possession. And this son spent all of what is supposed to get. Let me read the Bible with you and see what happened. In Luke chapter 15, verse 11 says, a certain man had two sons, and the younger of them said to the father, Father, give me the portion of goods that falls to me. So he divided to them his livelihood. See, what was the imperative word that was used? Give me. So it's like a command. It's like a command, it's not a request. Hindi niya sinabing, pwede po ba? Hindi niya sinabing, posible kaya? Sabi niya, give me. So you have to notice this because later we are going to study about what happened to the words when he was converted. He said, give me. And during that time, during the culture, in the Hebrew culture, when you ask for something, like the possessions of your father, it's like what? Now let me give you a little background. First, a younger son doesn't have any right to possess anything. It's the older son that possesses everything. Do you get the point? It's the older son. Next, you don't ask for your father's possession while he is still yet living. Hindi kayo hihingi ng possession hanggang ano, nabubuhay yung iyong magulang. So it's tantamount to what? It's tantamount to like killing your father when you ask for the whole possession. I mean, when you ask for the possession. And yet the father was so loving. The father has fear within himself. Meron siyang takot sa kanyang sarili na this son is not responsible enough to what? Responsible enough to take care of his own possession or to even to take care of himself. And yet he gave the son. Why? Because, you know, to love God is not arbitrary. It is something that you give voluntarily. Hindi yan pwedeng i-demand sa'yo. And yet the father gave it to his son with all the fears within his mind. Then, let's see. In verse 13 it says, and not many days. So what happened? You know, the father gave it to him. And what do you think would happen if the father would give the money? The Bible says, guard your heart with all diligence, for out of it are the issues of life. Why do you think did he get the money? You know, he was really bored with the way the father manages him. Alam nyo, na-upak na siya. Sabi niya, napakahipit naman dito sa bahay na to. Hindi ko magawa kung anong gusto ko. Kung magkakaroon lang ako ng pera, at kung magkakaroon lang ako ng kalayaan. Tandaan niyo itong dalawang ito. Magkaroon lang ako ng pera, magkaroon lang ako ng kalayaan. Naalala ko nung ako'y bata pa. When I was like 14 years old, dalawa lang ang iniisip ko dati para makapagiganti sa panday ko. Either magpakamatay,
o lumayas, o kaya talian ko siya at mumurahin ko siya buong araw. Bahala na siya kung ano mangyari sa kanya. And I don't know what happened, but the Lord worked in my heart. But during that time, lumayas talaga ako. Umalis ako, pumunta ako sa ano, sa bus station. Pagkatapos sumakay ako, nung naniningil na yung bus, wala akong maibigay, baba din ako. So napakahirap naman ito. And you know, there's still rebellion within my heart. Nung pumunta na ako sa Maynila, I was already studying political science in Far Eastern University. And while walking in Recto, I thought of staying away. I mean, naisip ko lumayas. Nonsense. Sabi ko, ba't pa ako lalayas? Nasa Mindanao sila. Nasa Maynila ako. Malaya na ako dito. Ang problema, wala akong pera. Minsan, I was not converted then. Alam mo yung ginagawa ko? Talagang nagko-commute ako. Nag-go 1, 2, 3. Kasi walang pera. Tapos, maraming mga kalayawan doon yung mga classmates ko. Inaaya nila ako. Pero dahil wala akong pera, wala akong magawa. Hindi ako makapagwala. So I was thinking, nalalayas ako. Iniisip ko, ba't pa ako lalayas? Eh, malaya naman ako. See, many of these meditations are in the meditations of the young people now that they think that their parents are too strict and that they're restricting their both the money and the freedom. And this child was what? Was so adamant to have freedom and wealth. And he thought that freedom and wealth combined together would give him happiness. And so for the last time, the mother cried, the father was sighing, and the father told him, the door is always open. A chair is always reserved for every meal. Amen? The door is always open. A chair is always reserved for every meal. A plate is always there for you when you would think of going back. But for the last time, he did not even dare to look back one more time. He spent his life, a prodigal son spent all his fortune eating and drinking with all his friends. And he was thinking that this would suffice his need for what? For dopamine. His need for satisfaction, for pleasure, and everything else that he would think he can do now. So while he was spending all his money, wasting all his money, something happened. A famine happened. Now verse 14, but when he had spent all, there arose a severe famine in that land. Yun ang problema. Nagkaroon ng tagtuyot. Nagkaroon ng taggutom. And he began to be in want. Alam nyo, iniisip niya, he was thinking that the money is what? That the money he had was what? Like half of the wealth of the father is indispensable. He thought that the money would not go run bankrupt. But lo and behold, not very far, I mean not very long, naubos na agad yon, and lo, dumating ang famine. And when the famine came, he began to be in want. All friends were gone. All pleasures were gone. And when he was looking at his own pocket, or at least his own wallet, there was nothing there. And for the first time, he began to be in want. Kahapon, katatapos lang ng survival camp. Ang conclusion sa survival camp. Na ang pin, sabi niya, ano yung quotation tungkol sa sky flakes? Sky flakes alam, heaven na. For the first time, they have, you know, they are in famine. Nagsispend sila ng time in the wilderness for 2 days with no food. And for the first time, pag binigyan sila ng sky flakes, bawat putil ng mga sky flakes talagang ninanamnam. At pagka nahuhulog yung kanin, natutong-natutong doon sa tubig, sisisirin para lang matikman. At bawat kamote, kahit yung uling na kinakain at ninanamnam pa. For the first time, they started to appreciate what they were starting to lose. It was not money. It was not food that the father was longing. It was the soul of these young people who is longing, whom he is longing. And you know what happened? Then he went and joined himself to the citizen in that country. Now he joined to the citizen of that country. For the first time, he loses his own citizenship. Why? Because he no longer practiced what his citizenship practiced. He no longer think the way his citizenship think. So he becomes a citizen of this world. He becomes a citizen of the world. And mind you, in verse 15 he says, and he sent him into his fields to feed swine. You want to go with me? I know you don't have food, but you can feed my swine. Perhaps you can have like food. And this is a Hebrew guy. And it's very degrading. It's shame. It's more than shame. To work in the field with swine and much more, eat with the swine. Parang Seventh-day Adventist na inofera na para sa piggery. And you know the next verse says, and this is what is very shameful. Listen very carefully. And he would gladly have filled his stomach with the pods that the swine ate. Habang tinitignan niya yung mga baboy, naglalaway siya. Sabi niya, ang sarap sigurong kainin. Pero habang kumakain yung baboy, pagkatapos maubos ng pagkain ng baboy, nasabi sa verse 16, and no one gave him anything. Mumuna nga lang ang gusto niyang kainin. Tira-tira na nga lang ng baboy, wala pang gustong magbigay. Sabi ng baboy, bakit? Pag-gutom mo yun. And while he was there, he was contemplating. He was contemplating. And Ellen White says, and the Bible says, while he was contemplating, notice this very carefully in verse 17, and when he came to himself, nasa Tagalog ito, at nang makabalik siya sa kanyang sarili, nasaan ba siya? Huh? You know, the first thing that should come to yourself is yourself. Minsan, nawawala tayo sa ating sarili. Pleasures would overcome us. Our self-control has gone wrong. Women, pornography, music, drugs, games. All of this pleasure that seems to suggest happiness and freedom does not suffice the very intimate soul that we long to have. The real happiness, not even food itself, can suffice. So what happened? And he said, and he would gladly have filled his stomach with a pot, but no one would give him. But when he came into himself, he said, how many of my father's hired servants have bread enough to spare and to spare, and I perish with hunger. Sabi niya, eto, pagkain lang ng baboy, wala pang matira sa akin. Kung nandun lang ako sa bahay ng aking ama, maraming tira sa mga servants ng aking ama. Marami sa atin ang papalak na ng mag-backslide. Ang mga parents natin, nakasulat na ang midweek at vesper na prayer request. At ang prayer request ay walang iba kundi tayo. Every morning, every evening, palagi na lang tayo at ang pangalan natin ang nakasulat. Prayer request after prayer request. The father and the mother knew that it was not the working of them that brings the child home. It's the working of the Holy Spirit that brings the child home. And you know what happened? When he came into himself, there was something that happened, and this is the grace of God. And he said, but when it came into himself, how many of the father's hired servants have bread enough to spare? And I perish with hunger. Now, he was thinking. Amen? He was thinking. And as Paul said, O wretched man that I am, and who shall deliver me from this body of death? Who shall deliver me? I will perish here. I will die here while the servants are there flourishing with food. The consequences of sin is death. Amen? And if we would realize that it is our own selfishness that kills us. Ellen White says in Christ of the Blessed, self-preservation is the way to self-destruction, and self-sacrifice is the way to self-preservation. He was thinking of what? He was thinking of indulging himself with all these indulgences. But it was actually killing him. And for the first time, he thought that the real source of life was his father. Amen? The real source of food was his father. He said, "Oh, wretched man that I am," says Paul, "cursed be the man that trusteth in man," according to Jeremiah, "and maketh flesh his arm." Alam nyo, napakalakas nyo mga young people. Ang problema, napakayabang ng young people. Alam nyo kung anong motto ng young people lagi? Alam ko na yan. Kaya pagka sinabi mo sa parents mo, alam ko na yan, lalong nagdududa ang parents. Pero pag dumating ka na sa point na sinasabi mo, "Ma, parang hindi ko kaya," lalo na silang nagtitiwala sa iyo. Lalo na silang nagtitiwala sa iyo. And he said, "Father, and I will arise and go to my father." Now this is the resolution now. That the Bible says, "For he shall be like the heat in the desert, and shall not see when good cometh, but shall inhabit the parched places in the wilderness, in the salt land, and not inhabit it." See, when you are against God, you live in the desert, where it's destitute of life, strength, and happiness. When you go away from God, you are destitute of life, strength, and happiness. This is the thinking part in the side of this prodigal son. He thinks of this, that it was his own course and his own will that sends him to these perishing places. Now the second step that he made is to resolve himself. Gumawa siya ng resolution. It's not about thinking about your own misery, but what can you do about your misery? What can you do about your misery? In verse 18, he says, "Father," he said, "I will arise." Amen? "I will arise," sandali lang. Nakamukmuk na lang ba ako dito? Sabi, "I will arise." And what will he do? "I will arise and go to my father." This is repentance. From one place of perishing place, of indulgence, now going back to the father is the solution. And what would he say when he goes to his own father? And see what are the words that he made. He said, "Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you." He has sinned against heaven and before you. "And I am no longer worthy to be called your son." He has a broken heart. Psalm chapter 51 says, "A broken heart, I will not what? I will not despise." So whenever the father sees you as with a broken heart, willing to what? Willing to be, to acknowledge your sin, just like David, "I acknowledge my sin. My transgression and my sin is ever before you. Create in me a clean heart, O God. Renew a steadfast spirit within me. Restore to me the joy of my salvation." This was a step that we need to do. But repentance does not come from our own misery. Romans chapter 2 verse 4 says, "The goodness of God leads us to repentance." Meron taga-klaan, nandun ako sa pastor. Gusto ko magbago muna bago bumalik sa Panginoon. Sabi ko sa kanya, "Wala kang planong bumalik sa Panginoon." "Bakit naman po, pastor?" "Kailanman hindi ka magbabago hanggang hindi ka bumabalik sa Panginoon." Amen? Ang pagbalik sa Panginoon ang paraan ng pagbabago. Hindi mo kakayanin magbago sa sarili mo lamang. Kailangan bumalik ka sa Diyos, kasi ang pag-ibig ng Diyos ang magbibigay sa iyo ng tunay na pagsisisi. And then he started to act. He rose up and started to memorize his script. So now, what is true repentance? True repentance is sorrow for sin. And what else? Going away from sin. And where you go away from sin, where do you go? Going towards righteousness. Romans chapter 2 verse 4 says, "The goodness of God leadeth thee to repentance." Huwag na huwag niyong isipin na magsisisi lamang kayo kapag ka na-realize nyo lang ang inyong kasalanan. Kung na-realize nyo ang inyong kasalanan, baka kagaya ni Judas, pagpakamatay lang kayo. That is nothing. It's the goodness of God that leads us to repentance. Think about the goodness of God. Always read the Bible, especially on the crucifixion of Jesus Christ when He suffered for you and for me. This would lead us to repentance. Open the pages of the Bible, especially when He sacrificed His own Son, that we might be saved. Jeremiah chapter 31 verse 3 says, I have loved thee with an everlasting love, therefore with loving kindness have I drawn thee. With what did God draw us? With loving kindness. Sa pamamagitan ng pagmamahal ni Kristo, pinalalapit niya tayo sa kanyang sarili. And now for the first time, usually ang lagi niya sinasabi sa Father niya, give me, give me, give me. This time there was a change in his own script. He started to say, make me. Amen? Make me is an acknowledgement that he cannot by himself do it. And make me what? Make me a servant, he said. A hired servant. Make me like one of your hired servant. And what is he expecting? When he goes to his father, he's expecting to be a slave, a servant. Is this the plan of God that when we come to him, he would make us a servant or a slave? So he was expecting that the love of God ay tinitingnan kung worthy ka o hindi. At pag hindi ka worthy, babalik ka, kailangan maghirap ka. But you know what happened? He said, Father, yan ang script niya, I have sinned against heaven and before thee. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me as one of the hired servants. So he was thinking that he is not worthy. And where does he base his worthiness? Where does he base his worthiness? Upon his own works. Tatanungin ko kayo, kung kayo ba'y nagkasala sa mga magulang nyo, hindi na ba kayo anak nila? Do you cease to be the son of God when you commit sin or mistake? Who tells you that you are no longer a son if you commit mistake? It's Satan. Satan was cast out of heaven, not because God does not love him, but because he does not love God. It was Satan's intention that when we sin, we would have guilt feelings, and after we have that guilt feeling, we would go against God and rebel against God because God cannot accept us because we are sinners, and yet this is not the grace of God. This is not the gospel. So he started to go back home, and he was thinking, where do I go back? Do I go back at the front door? Or where will I use the rear door? He was thinking, how would I start my conversation? How would I start my script? Anyway, with the courage that the Holy Spirit gave, he stepped his first step. And listen very carefully, while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and filled with compassion. See, while he was way off, the father was waiting there every single day. And when he recognized his son, you know, sometimes because of our own sin, we couldn't even hardly recognize ourselves. And sometimes even the people around us would hardly recognize ourselves. But the father, recognizes us by the way we walk, by the countenance that we have. He memorizes every bit of the shape that we have, and he knew that it was us. You know, when Ellen G. White was telling, and I was very much impressed in Christ of Jiglesa, that if you make the first step, at least the longing to repent, you don't need to do the rest. God will rescue you from where you are. Amen? Minsan kailangan maka 3 steps tayo para tanggapin tayo ng Panginoon. No! Just the longing. Magkaroon ka lang ng prayer. Longing na bumalik. Ang Panginoon ang bahalang pupunta sa iyo. Amen? He He's willing to rescue you from where you are because He knew you cannot rescue yourself. Sabi ko nga, meron ako mga backslider na dinalaw. Sabi na, Pastor, pag dumataan kami sa church, para kaming literally natutunaw habang nakikita namin yung Seventh-day Adventist Church. But when you started visiting us, you started giving us the light. Now, we can come to the church because you have brought the church to us. Amen? We should bring the church to them and not wait for them to go to the church. At pagdating nila sa church, titignan natin mula ulo hanggang paa, mula paa hanggang ulo. This should not be. And when the Father recognized him, he started to what? He started to be compassionate and he started to run after his own son. And there, he hugged his own son. And when his son started to speak, he said, in Psalm chapter 103, it says, like as a father pitieth his children, so the Lord pitieth them that fear him. And then he started his script. He said, Father, I have sinned against you and heaven. I am not worthy now to be called your son. Then before he utters his voice so that he could become a servant, the father said, clothe my son, put a ring on him. Kill a calf and call the people to rejoice. See, what lessons can we learn from here? A calf represents the death of our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, in order for a shameful thing to be honorable, something has to happen. Something has to happen. A blood is required in order to redeem the shame. Amen? Sabi niya, nung makita niya yung anak niya malayo pa lang, habang pinitignan niya yung mga kapitbahay, wala pang nakatingin, tumiretso na kagad siya, tapos binihisan niya kagad ng kanyang room para walang makakita sa kanyang kahihiyan. At nung makita niya, sabi niya, pinapunta niya mga servant niya, bago pa makita ng mga kapitbahay, sabi niya, ayaw niyang maalala ng mga kapitbahay yung shamefulness ng anak niya. Binihisan niya, binigyan niya ng ano, ng ring, pagkatapos ay nagpapatay siya kasi namatay ang kanyang anak. At ngayon ay nabuhay. Ang sabi ng Biblia sa Jeremiah 31:34, I will forgive their iniquity. I will remember their sin no more. Let the wicked forsake his way, and the unrighteous man be his thoughts, and let him return unto the Lord, and he will have mercy upon him, and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. He will what? Abundantly pardon. Arise ye and depart. For this is not your rest, because it is polluted, it shall destroy you, even with a sore destruction. Return unto me, for I have redeemed thee. Return. Laging sinasabi na paano, return. And during this time, the son felt the love of God, the love of his father. But you know, these are still introduction to my story. This is not the main point. I'm still in the introduction. The real deal, the real loss was not the younger son. Remember, the story was about the Pharisees and the Sadducees. They were not very happy for Jesus was eating and mingling with these sinners. And so the son said, and I'm almost to finish. The son said, very, very carefully. 28. But he was angry and would not go. Therefore, his father came out and pleaded with him. He was angry and would not go. His father pleaded with him. Ellen White says in Christ of the Blessed 210, self-righteousness not only leads men to misrepresent God, it makes them cold-hearted and critical toward their brethren. Unselfishness though. So self-righteousness ay nagiging parang indifferent. Habang nagsasaya lahat, nandun siya sa likuran, ayaw niya makisaya. He does not have want to have anything to do with any of that celebration. Why? Because he thinks that the brother is not worthy, that he's more worthy than his own brother. And because of this, he was indifferent. Ganito sa church, kaya tayo nag-away-away. Bakit? Kasi iniisip natin mas righteous tayo kaysa sa iba. At yung mga makasalanan, hindi sila deserving. You know, this was the story of the Pharisee and the publicans. The Pharisee was like, oh, thank you, Heavenly Father, that I am not like this publican. I do not this, I do not do this, I do not do this, and I do not do this. And the publican was what? beating his own heart, could not reach to heaven, could not even look up to heaven because he said, Lord, I am not worthy, I'm a sinner. Forgive me, have mercy upon me. And Jesus asked, who among them, from the two of them, received or become righteous or justified? Sino sa kanila umalis na justified? It was the sinner. And the Pharisees was still not just. Tanong ko kayo, sino ang justified? Yung just, sino ang ginawang matuwid? Yung matuwid o yung hindi matuwid? Sino ang pinaging matuwid? Sino ang inaaring ganap? Yung ganap o yung hindi ganap? Pag inisip mo na ganap ka, hindi ka naaaring ganap ng Panginoon. Hayaan ka na lang niya sa kasalanan. Pero pag inisip mo na hindi ka ganap, so kung magita ng dugo ng Panginoon, aaring ka ganap. Today, I would like to make an appeal. Sino sa inyo dito? Ang sa tingin ninyo, napaligo sa Panginoon. Sino sa inyo dito, ang sa tingin ninyo, ay naging rebellious sa kanyang magulang. Gustong mag-isip ng kalayaan. Gustong ispend ang kanyang buhay sa kanyang sarili lang, pero na-realize sa umaga ito na destruction lang ang kanyang pupuntahan. Panahon na para bumalik sa kanya. Kung ito ang inyong longing, would you like to come and I will pray for you. Today, the Lord calls you to be with God, to repent, to come to Him, receive, and you will be received by God. Praise God. Sino pa sa inyo ang nais magpasakop sa Panginoon today? Let's begin this day anew with God. Amen? Amen? Praise God. Gawin natin ito ng taos sa ating mga puso. Let us seek God today. Let us submit ourselves today. Let us receive the grace of God freely given to everyone who comes unto Him. He says, come unto me, all of you who are tired and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Learn from me, for I am meek and lowly in heart. Take my yoke upon you, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Would you like to pray with me? Heavenly Father, today we have realized that we are both sinners because we have gone away from you, or we are sinners because we are jealous of the people that you have forgiven. And either way, Heavenly Father, forgive our sins. Minsan, Panginoon, nagiging judgmental kami sa aming kapwa. At hindi namin nare-realize na mas ligaw pa kami kaysa sa mga makasalanang buhay. Minsan, Panginoon, pinagmamalaki namin ang aming mga sariling gawa, ang aming mga righteousness, ang aming mga good works. But this does not avail us to be a son. Panginoon, minsan nagiging jealous kami at sinasabi namin, bakit hindi kami pag-celebrate? Naglingkod kami ng tapat sa inyo, pero hindi paglilingkod ang nais niyo, Panginoon. Ang nais niyo ay maging anak niyo kami. Panginoon, sa matagal na panahon, anak niyo kami, pero para kami alipin na sumusunod. Dinadrag lang namin ang aming mga sarili para makasunod sa inyo, pero nahihirapan kami kasi hindi voluntary ang ginagawa ng may pagmamahal. Panginoon, sa araw na ito, tanggalin ang pagiging alipin sa amin. Alisin ang compliance at bigyan kami, Panginoon, ng pure, genuine, voluntary love, affection, and service to you. Sa araw nito, Panginoon, bubusan ang banal na Espiritu ang sino man nagpapasakop sa inyo. At ibigay sa kanilang kapayapaan, ibinigay nyo rin naman, Panginoon, sa lahat na nagpapasakop sa inyo. At mula sa araw nito, ang aling kami mga anak ninyo, at isulat ang aming mga pangalan sa aklat ng buhay, at huwag nang mawala pa hanggang sa kayo dumating. Ang lahat nito, itinitrain namin, Panginoon, ayon sa inyong mga salita, na ang sino man lumapit sa inyo, tatanggapin nyo. At ang sino man pang magsisi ay ililigtas mo. Ang lahat nito'y pinasasalamatan natin sa pangalan ng aming Panginoon Jesus. Amen. God bless you and God bless you.